If you've been around the voxel dev sphere, you might have heard Sparse Voxel Octree, or SVO for short, get thrown around. But what is it actually? Well, let's start by breaking down the name starting from the end. According to Wikipedia, a voxel represents a value on a regular grid in three-dimensional space, which might come off as weird as we usually think of voxels as just cubes, but just like their 2D counterparts, voxels are just values on a grid, but they're usually represented by a cube. This also leads to the main issues of voxels. If you want a high-resolution model, you have to have a high-resolution grid, which takes a lot of memory, especially since a lot of the grid will represent nothing more than empty space. That's where SVOs come in. The idea behind the SVO is that we only store voxels that we need. Instead of filling up every single voxel in 3D space, we only create voxels where there's actually something to render. Now, what is a SVO? Well, before we can understand that, let's understand what an octree is. An octree is a data structure used to partition 3D space into a hierarchy of smaller cubes, called octants. These octants can also divide their own space into octants. This happens recursively until you hit the desired resolution. The difference between an octree and a sparse voxel octree is how they handle dividing. Sparse voxel octrees does not always subdivide into 8 octants, while octrees always do. Now, the implementation of a sparse voxel octree can be a bit complicated, but the basic idea is pretty simple. We start off by creating a large cube that represents our 3D space. An example of the structure might look something like this, where we have a node class which includes a boolean for whether it's a leaf node or not, 8 children pointers, and some voxel data we might want to store. This node struct is then used in an octree class that keeps track of the size of the tree, the maximum resolution of the tree, and the root node. To populate the tree, we need an insert function. But before we get into the insert function, we have some groundwork to cover. Take this simple octree as an example. Each of these octants have a position of 0 or 1 in x, y, and z. If we take the binary value of those three axes for every single octant, we get an index that goes from 0 to 7. The octant with position 0, 0, 0 is index 0, and the octant with position 1, 0, 0 is index 1, and so on. Now that we know how to get the index value, we can look at the insert function. The goal of the insert function is to call itself recursively with the correct octant. To do that, we need these lines of code. The first line finds the size of the parent node using the size of the tree and depth, depth being how far down the tree we are, root being at 0. After finding the size, we can use it to find the center of the parent node, which is a bit more complicated. Finding the center of the root node is easy, we just add half of the size. But how do we find the center if we're further down the tree? Taking the simple quadtree as an example, to find the center of this corner, we first have to know how we got here. Our parent in this case is at position 1, 1, so that's the path we took to get here. If we take that and multiply with the size of our parent, we get the position of our parent. After finding the parent position, finding the center is as easy as adding half the size. Now, if we were to go even further down the tree, we would have to share every choice we made. To do that, we'd put our position in front of the position given to us and pass it down. That would look like this. Here's the code for the algorithm. This takes into account which octant a point belongs to by comparing it to the center of the parent, and keeps recursively creating nodes for the octant the point is in. So, what are the benefits of using a sparse voxel octree? Well, first off, it can dramatically improve performance. By only rendering the voxels that we actually need, we reduce the amount of processing power required to render a 3D scene. But it also allows us to store a lot more voxels in memory, because of the memory optimized way it stores voxels. But, as always, there's drawbacks. SVOs are great at storing and rendering voxels, but they struggle with collision detection and dynamic objects. So there you have it. That's a quick overview of sparse voxel octrees. If you have any questions, feel free to leave them down below. Thanks for watching.